Good morning, everyone. Can you hear me well in the back? Thank you. I was looking just at you. That's so funny. And you said, yeah. I'm thinking this morning, last time everybody was here super early. We were out on the lawn. And I told myself, this will never last. So, but it's good to see everybody. And I'm going to tell you later in the service where we're going to be next week, because we already know, but I'm going to wait till everybody's here to do it. And again, so good to see everybody, and you're blessed by this weather. We are, for folks who are joining us and worshiping with us from home, you're having communion this morning. So if you want to get the elements ready in your home, feel free to do that. This set was found and brought out by the firemen. And there's a special cleaner. I wash it with dish soap, but it still smells like smoke. So I'm not going to use that. It's here for symbolically, but just so you know that we are going to be able to bring some things out of the building. For those who have volunteered to help write thank you notes, we're going to gather on Thursday the 14th at 1 p.m. here at the manse to do that. And since we'll send out an email about that. And the other thing that I want to mention is that we ordered a new set of daily breads, which are the daily devotionals, and they are in boxes over there if you would like to pick one up and bring one home, or to offer and bring one to a friend. Anything else that I'm forgetting? Okay, let's take a deep breath. I invite you to make your breath a prayer, that as you inhale, you are inviting the Holy Spirit into your space. And as you exhale, you're letting everything else go. The Spirit of God is with us, present for us. And now is the time that we get to set the intention of being present for God. In that spirit of prayer, let us prepare our hearts for worship. Our call to worship this morning is a poem by Mary Oliver called Invitation. I will read the parts that are not in bold, and you are invited to say together the parts that are in bold. Oh, do you have time to linger for just a little while out of your busy and very important day for the goldfinches that have gathered in a field of thistles for a musical battle to see who can sing the highest note or the lowest or the most expressive of mirth or the most tender? Their strong, blunt beaks drink the air as they strive melodiously, not for your sake and not for mine, and not for the sake of winning, but for sheer delight and gratitude. Believe us, they say. It is a serious thing just to be alive on this fresh morning in the broken world. I beg of you, do not walk by without pausing to attend to this rather ridiculous performance. It could mean something. It could mean everything. It could be what Rilke meant when he wrote, "You must change your life." Let us pray. Gracious God, we attend to your spirit that is always and everywhere and with us now as we sit in the beauty of nature and we hear the sounds to serenade us, to remind us that you are and that you are with us and that your creativity is infinite and your power to recreate, to resurrect is also infinite. Lord, we pray that you would bless our worship, and we also pray that everything that we say and do gives you glory and honors who you are. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. You are invited to stand in body or in spirit as we sing, "It Is Well With My Soul."
It is well
with my soul.
Spoken, lived. May your word bring new life in our lives that we may embody your word in the world. In Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. Our scripture lesson this morning is Exodus 3, 1 through 15. Moses was keeping the flock of his father-in-law Jethro, the priest of Midian. He led his flock beyond the wilderness, and came to Horeb, the mountain of God. There, the angel of the Lord appeared to him in a flame of fire out of a bush. He looked. The bush was blazing, yet it was not consumed. Then Moses said, "I must turn aside and look at this great sight and see why the bush is not burned up." When the Lord saw that he had turned aside to see, God called to him out of the bush, "Moses, Moses." And he said, "Here I am." Then he said, "Come no closer. Remove the sandals from your feet, for the place on which you are standing is holy ground." He said further, "I am the God of your father, the God of Abraham, God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob." And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look at God. Then the Lord said, "I have observed the misery of my people who are in Egypt. I have heard their cry on account of their taskmasters. Indeed, I know their sufferings, and I have come down to deliver them from the Egyptians and to bring them up going with milk and honey to the country of the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Amorites, the Perizzites, the Hivites, and the Jebusites. The cry of the Israelites has now come to me. I have also seen how the Egyptians oppress them. So come, I pass out of Egypt." But Moses said to God, "Who am I?" He said, "I will be with you, and this shall be the sign for you that it is I who shall worship God on this mountain." But Moses said to God, "If I come to the Israelites and say to them, 'The God of your ancestors has sent me to you,' and they ask me, 'What is his name?' what shall I say to them?" God said to Moses, "I am who I am." He said further, "Thus you shall say to the Israelites, 'I am has sent me to you.'" God also said to Moses, "Thus you shall say to the Israelites, 'The Lord, the God of your ancestors, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob has sent me to you. This is my name forever, and this is my title for all generations.'"
I'd like to invite the kids forward. I saw Sam and Benjamin and Joshua and Sophia. You're allowed to be shy, but I saw you. And I got everybody's name right, right? Benjamin, Joshua, and guess what? Today is Sam's birthday. Yeah. He's 9 years old and going to third grade. When I had to talk on television.
Yes.
We could take a little bit of a smirk there. All right, can you get in close? This is a little tough. This is a video on YouTube I want to play for you. It's a dad with his little girl, and it's before, I think, the first day of school. And when do you start school? Have you started? When do you start? In 2 days? What about you all? 7 days, Wednesday. Wednesday, 3 days. Enjoy the next 2 days. And I know Teresa and TJ have already started. They've been since weeks now, right? They're not smiling. All right, so this is I think I'm going to put it next to the microphone so people can hear it. But this is a dad talking to his little daughter. They're looking in the mirror.
I am smart.
I work hard.
I am beautiful.
I am respectful.
I am respectful.
Yeah. Say, I'm not better than anyone.
Nobody's better than me.
I am amazing.
I am amazing.
I am great.
I am great.
What's your name?
Aaliyah Austin.
If you fall,
I get back up.
What are you?
I'm blessed.
Yes. So thank you, God.
Thank you, God.
For making me. The greatest.
The greatest.
There's nobody.
Better than me. Than me.
Five. All right. Did you get that all? All right. Pretty cool. Thanks. All right. That was my fear that an announcement would go off, and it did. All right. So what was the dad doing there with his daughter? Who's helping her? Yeah. Saying positive things, right? Trying to build her up to go to school and to believe in herself. I think, isn't that wonderful? We should all start our mornings with, you know, that positive things, telling ourselves positive things before we go in the day. The story that we just read in the Bible about Moses, God had this big task for him. And Moses was really afraid, and he was giving God, I'm going to talk about this later, but giving God a lot of excuses about why he didn't think. But God believed in him, or otherwise God wouldn't have asked him to do it, right? God believed in him to do it. But Moses was still afraid. But I don't know if you heard this promise. What does God say to Moses? I am with you. I am with you. Now, there's things in life that we can do easily. And then there's things in life where we say a prayer and say, oh my gosh, Lord, help. And hopefully you hear that whisper, I am with you. And that makes all the difference. But next week in worship, we're gonna bless the backpacks. And because next week starts Sunday school, and we're gonna officials beginning of the year and all that stuff. So we're going to make a special prayer for school and all that stuff. But just so you know, whatever God is calling you to, like going to school and being good students and working hard and all that, God believes in you and God will be with you. And that goes for everybody else, whatever it is that you're called to. Let's hold our hands, close our eyes, bow our heads. Gracious God, thank you for always being with us. When we're afraid, when we don't feel like we are enough, yet you remind us that with you, that's all we need. You are all we need. Lord, thank you also for brothers and sisters in faith who are there to support us and to help us when we need help as well. We pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you very much. And you're going to hang out here for the rest of the service. But Mrs. Walsh, did you remember? Is there paper and crayons or anything? Awesome, because I forgot. All right, so we have some stuff if you want to do. Okay, I'll see you later. And don't forget communion later, you're invited. Okay. Let's sing two verses of Breathe On Me, Breath of God. Please stand.
Breathe on me, breath of God, fill me with life anew, that I may love the way you love, and do what you would do. Breathe on me, breath of God, until my heart is pure, until my will is one with yours, you do and true and true.
Please be seated. And now's our time where we get to give over to God the ways that we are holding back, or the things that we have done that we're not proud of, the things that we need to be reminded of God's grace, and also the call to repentance to make right those things that we can. So let us, we're going to just pray silently. You give over to God whatever you need to. I'll give over to God whatever I need to, and I will close us and remind us of God's grace. Let us pray. Amen. Scripture tells us that as far as the east is from the west, so far have our sins been removed from us. Friends, believe the good news of the gospel. God is with us, will never leave nor forsake us, and we are forgiven. Amen. Let us, we're going to pass the peace first, and then we're going to sing. You're invited to stand up and share with one another the peace of Christ. And if you didn't notice, Pastor Margo is right in the middle there.
Yeah.
Too.
Yeah.
Christ.
Good
morning.
It looks like real church. Nobody wants to sit in front.
It's a little sunny there. That's true. It is. I guess if we ever do this again, we'll back everything up a little bit.
Okay, that's enough of that. And don't forget, there's fellowship after. But what a joy to see everyone and to wish one another the peace of Christ. And we can remain seated for this. We're going to sing one more verse of Breathe On Me, Breath of God. I made up my own words. Breathe on me, breath of God. Guide us in all we do. That our lives point to you always, betraying our faith in you. Let us sing. Okay, our second scripture lesson is the lectionary text for this morning. I thought we're right on. It's Matthew 16, verses 21 through 28. From that time on, Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and undergo great suffering at the hands of the elders and chief priests and scribes, and be killed, and on the third day be raised. And Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him, saying, "God forbid it, Lord, this must never happen to you." But he turned and said to Peter, "Get behind me, Satan. You are a stumbling block to me, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things." Then Jesus told his disciples, "If any want to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake will find it. For what will it profit them if they gain the whole world but forfeit their life? Or what will they give in return for their life? For the Son of Man is come with his angels in the glory of his Father, and then he will repay everyone for what has been done. Truly, I tell you, there are some standing here who will not taste death before they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God, and let us join our hearts in prayer. Gracious God, I pray that the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts might be acceptable in your sight, for you are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. A fire stopped a man in his tracks, and a voice came out of that fire telling him that he was standing on holy ground and that he should take off his shoes. And then he had a call for him that would cause him to face his fears and be God's agent of liberation for people who were living in slavery. There are moments in our lives that we remember because there's a choice to be made, and it's a biggie. It's either left or right. We either stay or we go. We give up or we keep going. It's the blue pill or the red pill. It's the road less taken. This was one of those moments for Moses. And so Moses, you know, heard this call from God, looked at the options before him, and then he chose to try to get out of it as best he could. Five different excuses he gives to God to try to convince God that God has the wrong man for the job. Exodus chapter 3, verse 11, "I'm not good enough." Verse 13, "I don't have all the answers." Chapter 4, verse 1, "People won't believe me." Verse 10, I can't speak well. And finally, verse 13, "Just send someone else, please." We have all said or thought those things. If you've done all of them, good for you. If you've checked all the boxes, you're in great company. My personal favorite, "Who am I that I should go to Pharaoh?" I say that a lot. Who am I to sign this document? Who am I to do this? I throw that one around. But God calls to each and every one of us, knowing who we are. Like I said to the kids, God knows our strengths. God knows our weaknesses, knows our past, our mistakes. Think about Moses, all the mistakes that he had made up to that point, our temptations, and the call remains. God says to Moses and to us, "I have these people that I love, that I need you to witness to that love to them so that they might know liberation through love and working for justice and service in the community." And by the way, yes, you can, because I will be with you. The temptation of Moses was to live for himself and not for God. That was also Jesus's temptation when Peter takes him aside and says, "Lord, no, this can never happen to you." He says, "Get behind me, Satan." Why so strong? Because that's how this Satan tempted Jesus in the wilderness. Live for yourself. You're wonderful. You're great. Why, you know, let everybody else work out their own faith with fear and trembling. What do you need? You're just, you know, you're the great deceiver tried to deceive. And I also want to point out, and I know that I've said this to you before, but if it was temptation for Jesus to live for himself, it wasn't easy. Otherwise, it's not temptation. right? It's if you're not tempted by it, I mean, some of you can't walk past chocolate, right? I can walk past chocolate. So I wouldn't, you know, you could tempt me in the desert with chocolate and I'd be, right? But we all have our things. But we know from the story of Jesus's temptations, he was tempted by it and he resisted. We're all tempted to live for self, both as individuals and as a church. I was talking to my friend Rich, who's had a church fire 8 years ago, you know, calling him up, asking for advice. And they're going to be moving back into the sanctuary in March. They have taken their time really looking at their building and the needs and designing it before putting it back together. They had, same as us, they had like an education wing, and they turned their gymnasium into a worship space. But what he said to me, and I said, Rich, we're on the same page. He goes, Robin, remember, ministry first. That has to be your focus. The building second. Number one is ministry. Our temptation might be to make the rebuilding consume all of our time and energy. But ministry happens in connection with people. It's creating relationships with people who need to know that God is and that God is with them and that that makes all the difference in the world. We're going to enter into a process to imagine and reimagine how the building can help fulfill our mission, your mission. We're not there yet, but we're going to discern. We went through a discernment process. All of our lives should be a discernment process. We're going to discern again, how do we create or recreate this building in service to how you have called us. And our mission statement is to connect with people through Christ, to serve the spiritual, physical, and emotional needs of the community and the world around us. The call remains. Before the fire, after the fire, God calls us. People need to know that I am with, and that makes all the difference because life can be incredibly hard and sometimes cruel, but knowing that God is with you makes all the difference. We could take our shoes off because we are, I want to say standing, I'm standing, you're sitting on holy ground because God calls out to us from this place. Our call is to move beyond our fears that take the form of excuses of why we can't do ministry. Oh, we don't have a building, or we can say, we don't have enough of this, that, or the other thing, people, time, energy, whatever. But if God is calling you to it, then you can do it with God's help. If God is calling you to it, you can do it. And you are called to reach out in love, to offer liberation to a community, which quite honestly, I mean, the expressions of love towards us, the connections that are reaching back to us in love because of what we've experienced is absolutely incredible. And I just want to share some stories from this week. If you have not yet, we got an email this week. Go to the website and we received an email because we're asking for stories of grace for people to share. Somebody who is from a different faith tradition will occasionally watch our service and online. He's Catholic, his wife is Hindu. And he had the most spiritual experience while we were celebrating communion that it'll knock your socks off. He was ripping up pancakes for his child in the high chair, and his wife was mushing up blueberries, right? And I said, apparently in worship, okay, those folks at home, lift up the elements that you have and break it. And then I said the words of institution, and it was like, and he was breaking bread in front, he was breaking pancakes. And the Spirit sat on it, and it was suddenly, he goes, I wanted to raise my hands and say amen. He goes, but I'm Catholic and I didn't do that. But go read the story because he does a way better job. He took his time writing it. It's beautiful. But he said the pancakes and the wine that was being made of the blueberries for his child. And I just, you know, it's being online and all this stuff has been so harrowing, you know, for me. I've had to, again, talk with God about it, not thrilled, but then you hear stories like this and you're like, hallelujah, amen. And I had my husband read the story. He goes, that's amazing. And I said, right? And then he goes, you're amazing, which he should say, right? But I said, no, I said, that is God. That is the Holy Spirit. That God is good. That is amazing. But it makes all of this like, yes, yes, Lord, thank you. But again, go to the website and read that story. We've gotten lots of donations from everywhere, and I don't have all the stories, but I just got a message yesterday from a pastor friend he's the pastor at Cedar Knolls, which is Tony McNaughton's church. Tony McNaughton grew up in this church. He became a pastor. He was in Cedar Knolls forever. He's retired in Maine. And Ross is the pastor of that church. And this is the Presbytery of the Highlands, where I have served for forever. Sarah Karate, her church, the Whippany Church, they got together and their hearts are broken for us. And they took an offering, and they're like, Robin, I've got $1,200 to give to you. How do you want it? You know, do you want to check? Do you want to, you know, all that stuff. But they are praying for us. I can't tell you how many expressions and churches that are praying for us, asking them, how do you need help? All of that stuff. You know, and I'm learning what we need. The church in Summit. So do you need hymnals? And I was like, yeah, actually, we are going to need hymnals. So those are getting picked up this coming week. And communion cups, you know, all these things that you don't, yeah, we're learning as we go, but the people are there to say, give us, tell us how we can help you. The churches in the area have all offered us their space. And so now that we're all here, I will tell you, next week we are going to be worshiping at Union Congregational Church on Cooper Avenue. The Exalt team, which is your worship committee, did the research, and then we had a small group of us check out both Central Presbyterian Church and Union Congregational Church this week. And we decided on Union Congregational Church, and we're going to see how it goes. Let me tell you what we're excited about. We are in a building separate from the larger sanctuary. We have the building all to ourselves. They have a chapel with movable chairs, which I'm excited about because that invites creativity into worship. But there's also a pipe organ and a piano in this little space. They have a sound system and the ability to stream. There are two handicapped spaces right by the chapel entrance and five spaces that will be provided on the street out front for those who might need to park closer. And we are worshiping at the same time that they are. So anticipating a little bit of you know, I'm just like, I don't want people to feel put out because they can't get parking. So those who are able to walk a little farther, please park a little farther out so that their folks who need to be close to the building and our folks who need to be close to the building can get there. But that we are able to worship at our same time is wonderful. They have two rooms for us to use for Sunday school. There's a small kitchenette, think New York City apartment, but it has a functioning dishwasher, which is wonderful. We'll be able to store our Sunday school supplies there. We're not going to have to lug in and lug out, which is wonderful. Bathrooms are handicap accessible. And when we're done with worship, we're going to have a table in the vestibule and we can have fellowship in the same space. What we're less thrilled about, but we're going to see how it goes. Anyone in a wheelchair will need to go outside to another entrance to come back in to get to the bathrooms. And there's a couple steps inside to move from the worship space to get to the bathrooms for everyone. But again, we're going to see how it goes. And quite honestly, I wish it was just a little bit. Neither spot was a home run, but this seemed to work. As again, with all of this, we're going to try it out, see how it goes. But again, the openness of the community to help us in time of need has been tremendous. Friends of Grace, were there Friends of Grace folks? It's St. John's Episcopal, right? St. John's Episcopal has, from what I heard, they're thrilled that they have a kitchen and a fellowship, and they're going to be able to serve the meals once a month for the, how do you say it? Housing insecure folks, right? And I was privy to a text chain of excitement until I think it was Irene who said, maybe we should let Pastor Robin off the hook here. Because we tend to go on and on. And because it was like boom, 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 text, 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 text of excitement and all that. And Irene, I was grateful. So the LOL, yes, but thank you. But the excitement, yes.
One of the nicest things about Friends of said no. She did such wonderful reaching out to the community, the VA community, and they actually changed one of their meeting times. So we would be able to have that space for Friends of Grace. And she called me back, but it fits in exactly with your sermon today. We are so grateful and blessed.
Did anybody else get chills listening to that? Yeah. All right, so I'm going to repeat it so that the folks at home can hear it. Originally, the church said no because they have an AA group meeting at that time, but they reached out to the AA group and they were willing to change their time so that we could do this. Oh, praise God. That's an important part of the story. Praise God. Amen. We have entered into a partnership with four other churches, including Union Congregational Church, to hire a youth director and for both middle school and high school. And that's the kickoff date is September 24th with an ice cream social. More information on that. But that's moving forward. Sunday school begins next week. The blessing of the backpacks, the PNC, the pastor nominating committee. We had folks here from the presbytery doing a training this week. The call remains and ministry moves forward. Praise God. And just as a final blessing, the God who is and was and whoever shall be promises to never leave nor forsake us. I can remember the times in my life where I have just either been scared to death or I have felt this small next to a huge mountain and looking up and wondering how I'm going to get from here to there. With every time where I have just, been afraid that I was going to be overwhelmed. And I have paused and prayed and said, oh Lord, that whisper comes, I am with you. And that has made all the difference. When you are feeling overwhelmed or sad, and allow yourselves to be sad, it is sad. But when you find yourself in those moments, breathe deeply, invite God into your space, and pray honestly. And I pray that you hear that whisper, I am with you. You are invited to, well, no, because it said the song says standing, so let's stand. Those in body or in spirit, we are standing, just the refrain from We Are Standing on Holy Ground.
We are standing on holy ground, and I know the Spirit is on the ground. Jesus, now we are standing in the presence of holy ground.
I ask you to remain standing as we join together in unison for the affirmation of faith found in your bulletin. Please join me. Let love be genuine, hate what is evil, hold fast to what is good, love one another with mutual affection, outdo one another in showing honor, do not lag in zeal, be ardent in spirit, serve the Lord, rejoice in hope, be patient in suffering, persevere in prayer, contribute to the needs of the saints, extend hospitality to strangers, bless those who persecute you, bless and do not curse them. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be haughty, but associate with the lowly. Do not claim to be wiser than you are. Do not repay anyone evil for evil, but take thought of what is noble in the sight of all. If it is possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all.
You may be seated.
We are going to take the offering, and praise God, I see offering plates. Now is the time. A lot of folks give online, thank you. And so don't feel guilty if the plate passes you. But there are some folks who like to intentionally put it into the plate, and so we will honor that. Now is the time for us to pray, because truly, you've heard the story of the woman who had nothing to put in the plate. But when the plate came by her, she said, put it on the ground so she could stand in it. Because I give my all. I give my time. I give my energy. I give God everything. Now is the time to ask, God, how are you calling me to step up and step out in faith? So with that, let us make this a prayerful time. And I invite the ushers, the deacons forward to take this morning's offering. Let us train our hearts in prayer. Gracious God, we offer ourselves to you. Thank you for the wisdom to take care of ourselves so that our cups are full, for creating space for joy and things that fill us, so that when we pour ourselves out into the world, in love for you and for them, there is enough. Lord, we ask that you bless these monies. May they be used to further your work and your will in this world. Give us discernment, give us wisdom, and give us the wisdom to always look to you and ask. Pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So we are going to celebrate communion this morning, and we're going to do it a little differently. I'm going to bring it to you instead of filing forward. And then we're going to eat together. I'm going to ask you to hold the bread in your hand, and then we'll eat as one, and we'll do the same with the cups. Again, this is not my table. It's not your table. It's not even a Presbyterian table. It is the table of Jesus Christ. And he invites all who come seeking him. Miracles happen at this table. And you don't even have to be in the room for that to happen. And praise God, we have more people than we anticipated. So here we are. Thank you, Tony. Let us join our hearts in prayer. Gracious God, your history with your people is a history of hardship and challenge and wilderness and presence and resurrection. We celebrate all of those things at this table that you promised to be with us in concrete ways. In the bread and the cup, we are reminded that you are with us in our very bodies. Your spirit resides. Lord, we are grateful for the long history of faith of those who have gone before us that we read about in scripture, the very fallible people who try to run away from you and you pursue them or give excuses as we do. What an incredible honor. How incredibly humbled we are that you can use us, knowing all that we are, strengths and weaknesses, mistakes, things that we try hard to forgive ourselves for, but seem to constantly come up or to tear us down, and yet you would call us and do to serve in this world, to love on other people, to work for justice, to create community where there was none before. Thank you for that call. Thank you for promising to never leave nor forsake us. Thank you for never giving up on us. Thank you for letting us know that grace is abundant and infinite. And Lord, I pray that this meal is not just a reminder, but it's something that we take with us into the world to give us endurance and strength to follow where you lead. Lord, I pray that everyone who comes into contact with any one of us, when they leave our presence, might feel built up and joyful for having been in community with us. Lord, I pray that your spirit might rest on the bread and the cup, fill them and fill us. Lord, we are grateful for Jesus, who, although he was tempted, put his love for you and his love for us first. Gracious God, we are thankful for his example, and that he would call us friend, or brother, or sister, or child of God. We are grateful that in his teaching, he taught us to pray. And we say together, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power and the glory forever. Amen. The Apostle Paul tells us that on the night that our Savior was betrayed, he took bread, and after he blessed it, he broke it, and he said, "This is my body given for you. Take and eat." In the same manner, after supper, he took the cup and he said, "This cup is a new covenant sealed in my blood. Take and drink. Whenever you eat of this bread or drink of this cup, you proclaim my death until I come again." Friends, these are the gifts of God for the people of God. And let all God's children say, Amen. So as a reminder, the bread is gluten-free and there is grape juice. And we forgot to do water for those who are not able to do grape juice, and we're sorry for that. But I'm going to, Dave is going to play, and I'm going to bring it to you. And there might be a little shuffling around, but again, hold the bread until we're ready to partake together. This is the bread of heaven given for all of us. Take and eat. For the juice for the cup, I'm going to ask for some volunteers since we have four trays to help me pass. Can I get the Simmons family to help me? Just take a tray and we'll just move it out. Salvation given for us. Take and drink. And you can collect those cups down the row, put it on the ground, and I'm grateful to God that for creativity and resourcefulness. Let us join our hearts in prayer. Gracious God, as you have been present to us in this meal, help us to be present to you and to your children in our daily lives. You call us to be light and life. May it be so. And since that is so incredibly daunting, even the idea of that, we pray, Lord, help, and we claim that promise that you are always with us. In Jesus' name, amen. I realized there was a story that I wanted to tell that I forgot to tell. I got to peek into other parts of the building that I didn't get to see yet just the other day. And I know that people got to see if you were opening your emails, and that's a hint, open your emails, from the church, of the painting of Jesus praying that was in the prayer room. If you look at the rest of the prayer room, it is a miracle that that painting survived. And you know, I'm sure it has the smell of smoke on it as, you know, as stuff comes out, but you can replace the paper backing. But if you look at the rest of that room, it is a miracle that, and I just, again, if you want, you know, just a reminder that little shot in the arm that says, I am with you. To me, that this week, that was that another one of those things this week that you're just like, oh, Lord, praise God. Let us stand in body or in spirit as we sing one more time. Breathe on me, breath of God, just the one verse. Breathe on me, breath of God, guide us in all we do, that our lives point to you always, betraying our faith in you. Let us sing.
Breathe on me, breath of God, guide us in all we do, let our lives point to you always, betraying our faith in you.
So let us go out into the world knowing that God is with us. Claim it. Believe it. Step out in faith and know that the God who knit you together in your mother's womb would die for you and did in the person of Jesus Christ, but he rose again in power and in spirit, making all things possible. Go in peace. In the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.